Well, the British tabloids had a field day with Harry and Meghan's explosive interview with Oprah. Keep in mind, the interview has not yet aired in Britain. Still, the Daily Mail plastered this headline across its front page saying, quote, Meghan accuses palace of racism. The Daily Mirror referenced Harry and Meghan's accusation that a member of the royal family was concerned about Archie's skin color. And the Daily Express led with the news that it was Kate who made Meghan cry before her wedding and not the other way around. But Piers Morgan wasn't buying any of it. He called the interview a self-serving whine-a-thon that did nothing but disparage the Queen and the royal family. Have a listen.
This is a two-hour trash-a-thon of our royal family, of the monarchy, of everything the Queen has worked so hard for, and it's all been done as Prince Philip lies in hospital. Mm-hmm. They trash everybody. They basically make out the entire royal family a bunch of white supremacists. They've trashed his dad, they've trashed his brother, they've trashed his sister-in-law, they've trashed everything the Queen has worked so hard to maintain with the monarchy. And they're supposed to believe they're compassionate.
Well, we brought in our royal expert, Stefanie Jones, to give us her perspective. So, Steph, what did you make of the interview and how much damage do you think this will cause to the royal family?
Oh, my gosh. Can I start with Piers Morgan first?
Yes.
Because to me, that's the most crucial at this exact moment in time. So I like Piers. I've met Piers on a personal basis, but this was completely outrageous. He's known for being very outlandish with his comments, and this time he's taken it way too far. I think it's very ironic because he works on the biggest morning show in the United Kingdom, and he is the face of that, along with Suzanne, who we saw him with. And ITV, the network in which it's produced, they have got the biggest mental health campaign going for the past year that you've ever seen, encouraging people during these dark times of COVID, come forward, speak if you've got an issue. And he has the audacity to not only say the comments that we've just seen there, but to also say he thinks she's a liar, that she was never suicidal. And I just think it's absolutely disgusting. He said, quote, if she was a weather girl, I wouldn't even believe the weather that she reported on. He's disgusting. I'm sorry, but you know what? A lot of this, we're talking about the tabloids also. We forget where Piers came from. He was the editor of one of those tabloids, and he's got to ensure that his name stays up in there because, you know, he's, you know, bordering towards the end of his career and he needs something to say.
Well, do you think, since you brought up he's going towards the end of his career, there also is a credibility factor in play here too, because as it was mentioned on the interview, that now we know that there is this relationship between the press and the monarchy.
Yes.
So, essentially, whatever credibility he had left has been discredited by it because now we know that he is in their or they're in his pockets.
Yeah.
Or he's in their pockets.
Yeah.
So do you think that that's a part of like this panic? Because I feel like this is a Hail Mary attempt to like help himself.
I think he needs something to say and he's scraping the barrel, to be brutally honest. And I think I want to be very clear. I am a big fan of the royal family. I am proud to be British and I am proud of my monarchy. And I do believe in sadness that a lot of the heads of our state are mere puppets to the institution. They aren't the people that are making the rules and governing everything. They are told what to say.
Wow.
See the royal family as, it sounds awful to say, but I see them as they're almost in an abusive relationship. They are controlled, they are told what to say and an image to portray.
They're the face.
And they're just the face of this. I mean, our parliament and the industry above them are the ones governing this. You know, so I think that's why Harry was so keen to protect his grandmother and his grandfather and say little towards his father and brother because their views are very skewed, unfortunately.
Can I challenge you, Steph, because coming from now, I do not know the monarchy like you do.
Mm-hmm.
For me, looking at it from an outsider's perspective,
yes,
I find it very archaic. I find it almost as if, and I'm going to say a really bold statement here, that could we abolish the royalty? Because in my opinion, in 2021, to have people have so much power because of their bloodline just seems everything that progress has worked towards is the exact opposite of.
I completely understand, and I've said this many times, I was very much hoping that Harry and Meghan would be the future of a very antiquated, archaic, and simply out of touch institution that are the face of our country, but they do a lot of good for our country, and they do a lot of good for the other 53 Commonwealth countries, which 60 to 70% of are not white. So it was a slap in the face when Harry revealed that some of his family members are next in line to the throne. That's how they're thinking, and I think that's going to have serious repercussions on how much power my country holds on the rest of the countries that they look after.
Right.
You're completely right. They broke the wheel, but in a way I didn't expect, and I hope that it brings change.
There you go. We all hope it brings change. Thank you so much, Steph, for that perspective. Coming up on DBL, the conversation about Harry and Meghan continues.